Hey everyone, Josh Powers here, and today we're going to do something a little bit different and go over some tips and tricks inside Mixer, as well as highlight a few of the lesser known features that will help speed up your texturing process. So let's get to it. To start, I want to show a very helpful feature that some of you might not know of, and that's color matching. Color matching will allow us to color match a megascan surface or a solid color layer to the average color of the underlying mix. For example, if I go up here and activate this concrete surface, we can see that the color is quite a bit different from the original Megascan's asset. But if I select this surface layer and then go down to the albedo, I can right-click on the color swatch and choose Pick Underlying, and Mixer will change the color to the average color of the mix beneath this layer. Alternatively, I can simply middle mouse click on the swatch to get the same results. This is a fantastic way to quickly match colors with the underlying layers, and then we can just go to the color adjustment window to fine-tune the results. And this feature works for the metalness and roughness channels as well. So if you're wanting to make sure your roughness values are close match, just middle mouse click the roughness swatch, and Mixer will automatically adjust to the average roughness value of the layers beneath. And if you want to revert back to the original values of the surface layer, you can easily do so by right-clicking on the swatch and then choosing Reset Color. Another useful color selection trick is being able to select an average color based on a set threshold. For example, most of you probably know that if you click on the color swatch, you can use an eyedropper tool to sample any of the colors inside the application. And this even works on the UI. However, if I move the eyedropper size slider up, I can go from a pixel-specific selection to a broader average of the pixels that fall within the selection ring. And to quickly be able to adjust the average sample size, we can hold down the S button and the middle mouse and then drag the mouse to dynamically scale the ring. The smaller the ring, the fewer pixels it will have to average, and the larger the size, the more it has to average. Being able to leverage specific texture layers of a megascan surface is a powerful way to add detail to your texture without overpowering the rest of your mix. And while this isn't necessarily a hidden feature, it's worth mentioning in case you haven't used it before. So, here I have a metallic surface that is just a bit too clean to be believable. Well, I can quickly add some roughness breakup to the surface by using the roughness map of a surface I brought in from the Megascans library. If I activate this scratched plastic layer here, I can then go down to the albedo layer of the surface and disable it by clicking this visibility icon. If I go ahead and do the same to metalness, displacement, normals, and occlusion, I'm left with just the roughness map, which I can then adjust to fit my needs. I can do this with any of the texture layers of a megascan surface or solid layer, which is very helpful to add those subtle touches to your texture without inheriting all the texture layers. And another quick way to add some breakup to the roughness map is to use an imperfection. If we click on the Add Surface Layer button, we can move over to the dropdown on the left side of the library and select the imperfections category. Then all we need to do is find a good imperfection we're happy with, and voila! The imperfection is automatically used as a roughness map overlay. Using the scatter modifier in conjunction with Megascan's Atlas textures is a perfect combination to create some unique mask data for your mix. So I wanted to show you a little trick to take this even further. So let's add a map component to this mask stack, and then we'll choose Library Asset. We'll click on the folder icon and then head on over to the drop-down menu on the left so that we can choose the Atlas option. Then we'll do a quick search for rope and choose this old rope atlas surface right here. Alright, we'll then choose the displacement texture for my source, and right away you can see that I have a nice bit of height information being used for this mask. However, if we go into mask mode by pressing 9 on the keyboard, we can see the problem we're having with pixel padding and other anomalies outside the subject matter of the rope itself, which gives us a lot of information we don't want. However, if I use the opacity texture for my mask instead of the displacement texture, when I go back to render mode, you can see that I lost the nice subtle details of the height map that we had before. Everything is extremely flat, and really all we're now getting is a silhouette of the rope. There are plenty of cases where using the opacity map alone is sufficient, such as the example I gave in the scatter modifier video using the opacity texture of a moss decal. But in cases like this, I want the best of both worlds by having the rope's height information while also having the negative space of the rope's opacity map. Fortunately, that's incredibly easy to do. First, let's go ahead and set the layer back to displacement. And then, with the layer selected, I'll press Ctrl and D to duplicate the component. Now, if I make this layer use the opacity mask, and then set the blending mode to multiply, I'm using the opacity texture as a mask for my displacement map, which leaves us with just the displacement map of the rope itself as our mask. Now all I need to do is add the scatter modifier on top of this, and I can create this tangled mess of rope all over the texture. And then by using a few solid layers and a megascan surface for the ground, I now have a tiling surface that was driven by two map components and a scatter modifier. Using Megascan's 3D assets to render out a Z-depth image is a fantastic way to generate height map information for your mask. For example, I used one of the Thai beach rock models from the Megascan's library to render out this image inside ZBrush. The end result gives us something of a displacement map, which we can now use to generate a mask. So I'll go ahead and toss a map component into my mask stack, and then I'll choose Add Image from the dropdown. And then I'll select my Z-depth image file here. With the image loaded, I can now use the scatter modifier to scatter this map around the texture, tweaking the various settings until I have a result that I'm happy with. Alright, that's looking pretty good, but I'll also add a gradient remap on top of this to give me a bit more contrast to the mask. And there we go. Now as I add some additional surfaces and solid colors to the layer stack, we have this truly unique, almost otherworldly tiling rock surface that we created from a Z-depth image extracted from a Megascan's asset. Alright, if you watched the tutorial video on the noise component, you might remember that we created a procedural dirt mask coming up from the floor in one of the examples. And let's say that this is a mask you use pretty frequently, but you're getting tired of rebuilding it over and over again. Well, we can solve this problem in one of two ways. The first thing that comes to mind is to utilize the smart material option by grouping the layer and then right-clicking on the group and selecting the export as smart material. This is definitely a viable option, however, smart materials will also include your surface or surfaces, and you may not always want to use that specific surface for your mix. Fortunately, if we go into the mask stack, we'll see three little dots at the top right corner of the stack. If we click on those dots and then choose the Save Preset option, we can save out our mask stack as it currently is. Then, whenever we want to create a similar effect in a completely different mix, all we need to do is go back up to those three dots and then find the name of the mask preset we just saved out, and boom, we've loaded the different components and modifiers of our saved mask into this stack. And like smart materials, once we've loaded them, we're free to adjust the settings within each of the components and modifiers, allowing us to fine-tune the mask for each particular asset. Organization is very important when it comes to texturing, especially as your stack becomes more complex. So I wanted to point out that you can group your mask layers together to help keep things nice and tidy by selecting the layers you want to group and then clicking on this folder icon down here. This way you can break up your mask stack however it makes the most sense to you, so that if you come back to it later or share it with another artist, the mask can be easily dissected and understood. You can also give color tags to layers and groups to organize things even further. Did you know that you can load any of the 3D Megascan's assets LODs into Mixer? Though it loads LOD 0 by default, you can select any of the LODs to use for your texturing by going to the Setup tab and choosing one of the LODs in this dropdown. And if you have it downloaded, you can even use the high poly source mesh. But be warned, high poly models are often over a million triangles, which means it can take a few moments to load into Mixer. And you might also notice a performance hit, especially in the viewport. However, if you do notice your viewport running a bit sluggishly, make sure you disable the displacement setting by pressing this icon here. You can also toggle this by pressing D on the keyboard, which will definitely help make this scene run a bit more smoothly. In most cases, seeing your mesh in 3D space is all you'll need to texture your models. However, there might be instances where you want to be able to see the model's textures in 2D. And you can do this by going up to this dropdown here and then choosing Plane. This will let you see your model's textures on a flat plane. And it'll work with the different rendering options as well. And for surface textures, you can also use the same dropdown to choose from a few different primitives to display your textures on a variety of different types of surfaces. Mixer is full of incredibly useful features, both big and small, that are there to help make your texturing experience be a positive one. I hope this video was able to shed some light on some tips and tricks that you might not have known about so that you can create textures faster than ever. Thank you so much for watching this video, and we'll see you in the next one.